Hi everyone, thank you for inviting me. I'm very happy to give this talk. My name is Ira Kemelmacher-Shlizerman. I'm gonna talk about the future of communication. In particular, I'm gonna talk about three works from my team that we've been working on this year, two related to video and one related to audio. I've been interested in the topic for several years now, but it became even more urgent this year, where most of the time we spend communicating with people in video calls and video conferencing. So my team and I would like to make it as a high quality as possible for everyone. So let me start by this video, which it's pretty hilarious, and that was before COVID times, but it's a serious person, a professor, talking about North Korea and the political situation that surrounds it with BBC News, but he's taking a call from his house. So if you haven't seen it before, you'll get ready for a treat. Let's watch it together.
Scandals happen all the time. The question is, how do democracies respond to those scandals?
And what will it mean for the wider region? I think one of your children has just walked in. I mean, shifting sands in the region. Do you think relations with the North may change?
I would be surprised if they do. My apologies.
For the region.
My apologies. South Korea's policy.
So this is pretty funny. I'm sure that in retrospect, it's a great video. But he would possibly rather to not have the background in while he's talking with BBC News. And you know, recently it's becoming more urgent. Our conversation happened in any place, in different apartments, and so on. And so people, due to privacy or other reasons, would rather remove their backgrounds because they're not very exciting. And so, or replace them for something more appropriate, official, or whatever is needed for the particular conversation. So this is the problem that we've been working on. And you will say, yeah, but you know, like Zoom already has this feature, we can replace the background, like I'm doing it right now. And so why can't we just use that? So here's a sample video that we've taken using Zoom's background replacement. And so Andre here is moving around, and you can see all the artifacts that happen with the usual background replacement algorithm. So you can see problems in the hair area, when hands are moving, things are becoming blurrier. When there is motion, things are becoming like more artifacty and so on. Check out the neck area and so on. So we would like to solve all of those and make it as high quality as possible. Remove all the artifacts. And this paper is about that exactly. We call it background matting. The world is your green screen. And that appears at CVPR 2020. The lead author is my postdoc Shumdeep, and Vivek Jayaram was working on this project as well, a PhD student in my lab. This collaboration with Brian Curlis and Steve Seitz. So let's see what it means. So here's a direct comparison of a similar frame captured with Zoom's background replacement and our algorithm background matting. You can see that the artifact disappeared. Look at the areas around the hand, look at the hair strands and so on. So that looks pretty good. So how did we do that? And let's see a video version of that as well. Let's take a look at a few more examples. This is the captured video, and then here's our result. When I show our result, I show estimated alpha and foreground, where we talk about alpha, if you're not familiar with the terms, in a second. So given that we can estimate the foreground, which is a human, and the alpha, we can put any background behind her and it will look realistic. So what is the, let's lay out the space of different ways to solve this problem. So the first one that I already mentioned that is similar to zoom or at least similar in some way is background subtraction, means that we're gonna use features like color to be able to understand what is foreground, what is background, or motion perhaps, and so on. And this typically creates artifacts because foreground and background colors coincide, or motion coincides, or things like that. So that's not the best solution. The other way to go about it is to use segmentation algorithms. And in fact, even we have really good human focused segmentation algorithms these days, which can work, except that on the silhouette, when you look on the outline of the person, you see all these little artifacts that make it look very synthetic. So it would be great to remove those. And the third way, and so the way to remove those is what is called matting. And so the idea is, and this is what we do, a new algorithm to matting. And so the idea is the following. We are interested in estimating alpha, which is denoted here as green letter A in every pixel. This is a number between 0 and 1 per pixel, such that when we multiply, F is a foreground and B is a background. So when we multiply by foreground, this alpha, this is pairwise multiplication, at the background multiplied by 1 minus alpha, we'll get a nice image that combines the background and the foreground, where alpha is the alpha map and foreground is the human. And these are the two that we would like to estimate because in the future, we would like to replace the background. And so let's understand that for a second. So when A is equal to 0, we get just background. When A is equal to, sorry, we get just, background. When A is equal to 1, we get just foreground. So that's the definition. So let's look on comparison, a video comparison of our method and background subtraction method. So at the bottom, you see the background subtraction, and at the top, you see our method and composite. So you can visually understand the artifacts that can occur. Here's a similar comparison with the segmentation. So it's much better at understanding where the foreground is, but still the silhouette and the outline is not as great. So matting is, of course, this is a very well-researched problem. And so we haven't invented matting. Typically, the way that people approach it is that given an image, there is a manual tri-map that is estimated. A tri-map means that it's separation to three things. Each pixel gets a label. Is it definite foreground, definite background, the blue ones, or it's unknown? And then the whole problem of matting is how to find the right A numbers for this green area, the unknown area, in a way that will create the best composite. For example, for hair strands, you could imagine that A could be half or some transparencies included. All right, and the key idea of our algorithm is the following. So while we do not want to create tri-maps because they're created typically manually, if you wanna get a high quality tri-map, and it's just not possible to do it for every frame of a video, we can do the following thing. So we take a video of a person that we want to replace the background for that person, or when we take our own video, like during video call, we can take our own video. And then the second thing that we do is we also capture the background. And now this doesn't have to be very aligned or accurate. As you can see, Vivek here is using a handheld camera and the frame moves a little bit. So it's okay to have little motions and shakiness and so on for our algorithm. So this is a setup. We have a background image and we have the person in that background. And then the algorithm goes in two steps. So step number one is a supervised learning part where we use pairwise, we have pairs with ground truth. So There is an Adobe Composition 1K dataset that has 450 ground truth alpha mats that somebody labeled manually, or perhaps with green screen, composed into 100 random backgrounds. So we created this dataset, and now we actually have the ground truth alpha mat, and we have an image, and so we can run pairwise supervised learning that will allow us to estimate the new foreground and alpha mat. So how do we do that? Given a frame, a background, and a segmentation. So this is a rough segmentation of the human. We build a context switching block, which is doing the following thing. It takes the frame, encodes it. It takes the background, encodes it. It takes the segmentation, encodes it. Background segmentation are used as prior. Then there is two selector blocks and the combinator block that combines everything together. And the idea is to effectively choose the input cues, which cues to use and which cues are not as important. Given that, all that goes to rest blocks and then decoded into a pair of images, which are foreground and alpha, approximate alpha mat. This alpha mat is not great yet because we don't have a lot of data, pairwise data. And also there is no way of understanding if it looks, you know, realistic and good enough just by usual losses. And so our second step, which we found very effective, is to use GANs for refinement. And we do it in the following way. So we still have as input frame, background segmentation. Now the green box is our step number one generator. So we can generate the alpha in the foreground. And then the yellow generator is the one that we're training right now. And so it generates foreground and background. We have the generator from step number one. There is a loss between the two. Then we combine and compose it with many different backgrounds. And we can have as many backgrounds as we want, combine them together, and then we send it to discriminator and ask, is this real or fake? And so this way, the network learns how to create real images that looks after real images after composition, which in consequence creates good alpha mats and foregrounds. So this concludes the algorithm. Let's see a few comparisons. In the top row here, we show the difference, and you see the variation in the lighting and in the clothing and in the backgrounds and outside, inside, and so on. The second row shows our result after step one, which is a supervised learning. And you can see that some artifacts still exist. It's pretty rough. And then the bottom row shows ours after step two, which removes the artifacts and creates a higher quality result. All right, some comparison with state of the art. We compared to more or less all the work at a time. And here's a short video showing those comparisons. So ours is on the left top and the input is on the right top. And the four methods that we compared to were at the bottom each. At the top right now, we saw the step one result. Here's another video. So those results are typical, and there's many more online. You can check it out. All right. Similarly, composing into a new background. Which looks pretty good. All right. Some limitations of the algorithm. So here you see, for example, in red here, you see when the motion of the background, the existing background correlates with the motion of the person that raises the hand, for example, here, you will still see artifacts. We can't get rid of those artifacts. So that's one limitation of the algorithm. And these are more results showing two people in the frame and more complex hair scenarios. The context switching block turns out to be pretty important in our algorithm. Here's a ablation study where we see that without context switching at the middle row here, we see artifacts and missing parts in the alphabet. The code is online and it's pretty popular, so feel free to check it out online and see more results and try it out. The training and the inference code is online. And people used it, for example, Microsoft used it to create a virtual stage for their build conferences, conference this year. And even the CEO of Microsoft, Satya Nadella, talked about our work in his CVPR keynote. So that was pretty exciting, and many more other creative ways of using the code appeared online. Okay, some limitations that some of them I already mentioned, but a big one is that, you know, I'm talking about the future of video communication and so on, but while the algorithm performs really well and state of the art, it is still not applicable to real-time meeting. It's only 8 frames per second or so. It also works on pretty low resolution, 512 by 512. Not very low, but lower than like HD and what we would like to have in high quality conversations. We obviously need a background capture in the beginning, which makes it a little tiny bit more challenging to use, although not a big deal. Shadows and reflections will create artifacts. We know that. Big camera movement will create artifacts. So all of these things need to be solved. And hopefully some of those will be solved in the next years. We in particular were really interested about the first part. So we wanted to create a method that allows us to run real time and even in better quality than background meeting, applying to HD and even 4K resolution. And so this is the next work that we've been working on the last half a year or so. And we built an algorithm that can work in real time, high resolution meeting. This is work done by students, Peter and Peter here and Andre and my postdoc Shumdeep in collaboration advised by Brian Curley, Steve Seitz and myself. All right, so the results are pretty cool. So we were able to get 4K resolution at 30 frames per second and the HD resolution at 60 frames per second. And the quality is better than background meeting. The input is still source. We still need the source and background image as before. And the estimates are, and the outputs are the same. We have alpha foreground and result. But you can see now details of the hairs are even better. Really fast sequences work even better than before. And it's all in real time. And Andre and Peter even built a Zoom plugin. So you'll see that they use it in their Zoom conversations right now, which is pretty exciting. Here, Andre replaces his background and using it in Zoom. So currently it needs GPU and works only on Linux, but we'll work on making it more widely available. Here's a comparison to Zoom. Ours is on the right. Here's a comparison to green screen capture and DaVinci Resolve software. You can see that we are pretty comparable to, if not better sometimes, to what green screen creates. And so the idea is the following. We have two networks. We have a base network, which is a coarse network, and then we have a refinement network. Let's see how they work. So the input is a source and background, as before. Then the coarse network is responsible in creating a coarse alpha and an error map. So this is a key in this algorithm. Now the error map pixels are only the ones that are sent to the refinement network, and the alpha and foreground is improved only on those patches. This makes it extremely fast. And then the final result combines the new patches, the refined ones and the old ones from the coarse network. So here's the coarse alpha. And then the error map, and here's the refined alpha. Here's a comparison to previous state of the art, which is background matting, the paper that I described in the beginning. You can see that although it's pretty good with hair, it still created little artifacts when she moves, and there's really thin strands, while the new work improves over that. So background matting was 7.8 FPS on 512 by 512 resolution. This current network is 33 FPS on 4K, 60 FPS on HD. And if we instead of ResNet for feature mobile net, we can even get to 100 frames per second for HD resolution. Check out the code online. All the code inference and training is out there. And feel free to use it. All right, so we talked about video, where we were able to get a pretty high quality matting for video conversations. We got it to real time stage. It's still, real time. It needs GPU and it a strong GPU. So we'll work on making it real time on other machines, but it's very, very promising and already usable machines with GPUs. But how about audio? So a big part of a good video call is a person's audio. We've all experienced, where audio cuts off and you can't hear the person, or it's kind of noisy because there are people behind you, or you just don't want to, you want to separate your voice or the voice of the person that you're talking with from all the other noises that happen out there. And so, here's an example of Vivek, my PhD student, that is trying to have a call in his house and his family keeps interrupting him.
Test. I'm trying to do a video call right now and one person in the house is using the blender and another person is vacuuming right behind me. This is the kind of scenario which one might experience when trying to take calls while working from home. And our goal here is really to see if we can separate out one speaker in order to provide a good video conferencing experience.
And here's the output.
So this is a recording test. I'm trying to do a video call right now, and one person in the house is using the blender, and another person is vacuuming right behind me. This is the kind of scenario which one might experience when trying to take calls while working from home. And our goal here is really to see if we can separate out one speaker in order to provide a good video conferencing experience.
So you will notice that the blender noise and the vacuuming noise disappeared, which is what we want. Vivek's voice is still not perfect and we'll be working on that, but it is pretty, at this point, it's state of the art of what is possible. So we call this work the cone of silence. This is an audio only work. There is no video cues that are used on this work. And the idea is the speech separation by localization. So we use the spatial environment of the audio to help speech separation. This work is done by Tirapat on the right here and Vivek on the left here, equal contribution advised by Steve Seitz and myself. It appeared at NeurIPS 2020 as an oral. So why did we call it cone of silence? Because the algorithm is kind of doing cone of silence and it's kind of doing like a cone in the space, as you'll see in a few seconds. The idea came from my show from many years ago that it's called Get Smart. And they use something called cone of silence to create private conversations where only the two people that speak can only hear what they say when it's secret or needed only the two speakers to hear it. So let's watch it for a second. It's pretty funny.
What's up, Chief? Why the magenta alert?
86, I'm deeply concerned about the conference this afternoon. We have reason to believe that control may have been infiltrated.
Why?
The alarm went off on the conference room door. Now, it may have been a malfunction in the electrical circuit, but on the other hand...
Yes, I see what you mean, Chief.
I assume you have the key to the conference room door.
That's right, Chief. And no one can take it away from me. Not as long as I have it on the security chain that was developed by Professor Windisch.
Good. Now, from here on, everything is Class A security. Here's what I want you to do.
Wait a minute, Chief. Didn't you just say Class A security?
I did.
Well, then shouldn't we...
Do you want me to leave the room?
That won't be necessary, Hodgkins. We can talk under the cone of silence.
the cone of silence?
Well, this is a magenta alert, isn't it?
The cone of silence. I am deeply concerned about the conference room.
What?
I'm concerned about the conference room.
How's that?
He's concerned about the conference room.
How?
I want it thoroughly inspected for hidden devices, microphones, bombs.
What?
Check for microphones and bombs.
How? Well, do you really think that's necessary?
Okay, you get the point. So the point, they had this device that you put on the two speakers and it didn't really work, but it was supposed to create a private conversation. So in our case, the method works. Let me explain how. I showed in the beginning an example of a person sitting and people are vacuuming behind him and blender and so on as a background noise. It also, the algorithm actually works with background noise or other speakers, human voices. And so here's an example of input where four people are sitting and they talk simultaneously or across, like in pairs. And we would like to, the algorithm would like to separate each speaker so that we'll hear what each speaker says. So here's the input.
Orange versus red. Where do you stand on the whole orange versus red debate? Eat the lemon as you know. I think that red is definitely.
All right, that seems like a big mess.
Orange versus red. Where do you stand?
Here's the output. So, and what you see on the right here, this is the, so our algorithm is focused on separation by localization, separation of the speakers via localizing where the speakers are located. And I'll talk about how we capture this audio in a second. It is captured with a microphone array. But let's look on the plot on the right. This is basically our, this is how we define our space in X, Y. And the speakers are denoted by those little cones. And so each speaker is denoted by a cone and the direction where they're sitting. So, so two are in the top left quadrant, one is in the bottom right, and one is in the bottom left, according to how the people are positioned around the microphone array. The microphone array sits in the middle of the table here. You'll see it in a second in a new slide. But let's see what the algorithm was able to create.
So orange versus red, where do you stand on the whole orange versus red debate? No, I think that red definitely a better color. Okay.
So you will notice that Vivek's voice was able to be separated from the other voices and we could actually hear what he says. Now, again, still artifacts exist. And so a lot of future work ahead of us, but it's getting pretty well and we can actually understand what he says rather than the previous video where it was a total chaos. Okay,
so
the idea is the following. So we define our problem as follows. So we assume that we have M microphones and this is by a physical microphone array that we put here in the center of the table. We have N speakers. And in this case, in this example on the right here, there are two speakers. And then we observe, in the previous example, it was four speakers and so on. We observe audio mixture M. The M is a summation of all the audios of the speakers, SI, plus some background. So background noise is included separately. And what we would like to do is recover speaker signals, S1 up to SN. And we also want to recover their positions, which we define by their angular locations, theta one until theta n. Okay, the advantages of our approach are, we allow unknown number of speakers, unlike state of the art in this area, and they can be varying. We do localization and separation at the same time and they help each other. The speakers can move, as you'll see in some of the examples. We allow non-voice background sounds as well as multiple speakers, human voices, and we achieve state-of-the-art results. So how does it work? On a high level, there is a microarray in the center. This defines the 0, 0 position. the direction is defined by theta, and then there is a cone defined by W. This we call W is the angular window, and the theta is the target angle of the speaker, where the speaker is located. And then we have a deep network, which is a separation network, that given a space, a theta and a W, it tries to understand to separate the speakers in that area. And they help each other. The way that the so the separation network assumes that it's given theta and W, and the localization part is a binary search that subdivides the space to smaller and smaller part where the separation network can run. So the separation network is based on wave unit. It works in the waveform domain. I'm not gonna go into details, but the mixture, just on a high level, the mixture goes into a component. Let's talk about that in a second. So shifting component, then it goes into encoder, LSTM decoder with some skip connections, and it includes the window size and the target angle. Now the shift is very important. The shift part is very important because some of you know, when you have, we have two microphones and the signal arrives to the microphones, there might be a time delay between the two mics. And so we have to align them first to make sure that the mixture is combined correctly. And so that's what we do. So this is the unaligned, this is mic one, mic two, unaligned combination, and this is after shift. So we always do a shift before we send it to the separation network. All right. Let's see what it does, the combination of them, what it does, like localization on top of separation. So we begin by, so in this example, we have four sources. So source number one, two, three, four. You can see it on the left here. Let's listen to them.
There's a story.
Media again, denied the following year.
Okay, so this is a combination of four sources. And initially we divide the localization part. We divide the our space to four quadrants, and the separation network runs in each quadrant. So it is able to find one.
Here again, they were denied a voice.
And then the second quadrant here still has a
expected by October the following year.
The purple and the blue quadrants don't have any noise, any audio at all. So we remove it from further computation. We subdivide the quadrants again to now each of them to halves, and keep running the separation network over smaller and smaller pieces until we use null max suppression to understand where the sources are. All right, let's see a few other examples, and I invite you to go to the webpage. We have many examples and the code and the paper, lots of explanations there. Okay, so let's see a few more examples.
Lakes are polluted. There's
so much plastic in the ocean.
Okay, but she doesn't think that blue is a good color.
No, she thinks
blue.
I'm not wearing blue. She's definitely red is a better color.
Talk about the orange.
Green is a good color.
Okay, let's forget about these guys and continue talking about the best.
Water, no. Okay, so nature's color is green. Water is part of nature. And honestly, most water is green these days. All the lakes are polluted. I mean, really. Okay, but she doesn't think that blue is a good color. She's not wearing blue. I'm not wearing blue. Orange. These are orange. Orange pants. Best color ever. Orange. Orange. It was definitely orange. Also, orange is fascinating as words. But they're delicious. The oranges are great. I love the orange.
So, orange versus red. Where do you stand on the whole orange versus red debate? No, I think that red is definitely a better color. Okay. They're better than apricots, they're better than plum, they're better than peaches, they're the best. I don't think so. I think lemons are still the better one.
So that was a very deep conversation, which one is better, red or orange. But I think it illustrates really well the capabilities of the algorithm. So first of all, it works on real data and real conversation with many speakers, unknown in advance, and they all talk in different voices and different strengths and so on. So that definitely makes it very impressive. On the other hand, you can see also the limitations. Some of the voices are a little noisy, and there is still quite a lot of work there. Okay, a few more examples. Here's another one with a moving source.
Of modern linguistics, one of the founders of the field of cognitive science, and perhaps the most avidly read political theorist and commentator of all. Of modern linguistics, one of the founders of the field of cognitive science, and perhaps the most avidly read political theorist and commentator.
16 hours right now. I have to wait until I'm working here 40 hours to wrap up another single.
All right. So this summarizes my my talk. I talked about high quality real time audio and video for communication purposes, for better video calls and other applications as well, as in the speaker separation scenario. There is, I believe, we did really good progress, and there is still a really several exciting ways to improve those methods. And a food for thought here for the audience is, what other components are missing? You're using video conferences every day or so these days. Is there anything that you want? Perhaps you just want to, you'll figure something out and you'll solve it. If you want to talk about any of that, connect, collaborate, feel free to contact me. Check out my webpage. It has, I talked about this space of works that I'm excited about. I'm also working, my team is also working on other exciting projects. So check out the webpage for the different new works out there, or feel free to check out my Twitter and send me a message on Twitter. That seems to work the best these days. Thank you so much, and this concludes my talk. Bye.